Hello friends, welcome to the second part of UV and visual spectroscopy. Before starting the second part, I would like to thank Rupam Sinha for sharing this presentation with me. So in the first part, we have talked about different energy levels, and here we'll be talking about the selection rules. So just to recapitulate, I'll tell you those are the energy levels and those are the transitions basically which are possible in UV and visual spectroscopy. Those are sigma to sigma star, sigma to pi star, pi to pi star, n to sigma star, n to pi star. There are all possibilities, but you have to be governed by a selection rule, and we'll be talking about the selection rule today here. So the selection rule is very simple. You have to follow the spin quantum number. Now there is some capital S which is called spin quantum number, which is equal to 2s plus 1. 2 into small s plus 1. Now small s is the summation of the all spin states, si say. So here are two electrons in the ground state, and the quantum number, spin quantum number is different. Say one electron is moving in the anticlockwise direction, so the other is moving in the clockwise direction. If one is denoted by plus half, then the other would be denoted by minus half. So the summation of SI in this case would be plus half plus minus half, that means 0. So the 2s plus 1, here s is the summation of this SI, so this is coming 0 for this particular case. So 2s plus 1 would be 1. If this is 1, then it is called singlet state. Now if the electrons would have been same spin state, that means plus half and plus half, then the summation of SI would have been plus half plus plus half, that means 1, then 2s plus 1 would have been 3. So this is singlet state and this is triplet state. Now the selection rule says transitions are possible from either singlet to singlet or triplet to triplet. But singlet to triplet or triplet to singlet transitions are not possible. So you need to maintain the quantum spin quantum number. That is the main selection rule you have to know. So here I have shown in the first excited state, this is the singlet one. This one is the singlet one. And in the ground state, it was also singlet. So from this to this transition is possible. But here it changes the spin. You can see it was in the downward and it is in the upward direction. So it has changed its spin. So it is going from singlet to triplet. So that means this transition is not possible. So this is forbidden. I have shown here this transition is forbidden. So now you have to understand two more terminologies. Actually there are four important terminologies associated with absorption spectra. Now before coming to this terminologies, I will tell you something about the absorption. So what happens when you put a molecule in a cuvette? Basically in UV, you have a cuvette where you put the sample. Then the sample is in the solution state. Solution means you put the sample inside water, you make a dilute solution and you put it in the cuvette. And the cuvette is placed inside the instrument. Now what happens, UV comes and it goes through the solution. When it goes through the solution, some sort of UV or visual light is being absorbed during the passage of the light. And due to this absorption, it shows a peak. So here you can see there is a peak, say around 210, there is a peak, 210 nanometer, there is a peak. So this is the absorption peak. Now what happens, this absorption peak is the characteristic of a molecule. Now if you change the molecules little bit, that means if you put some more groups in the molecule or remove some groups, then what happens, then the electronic environment of the molecule or the energy states changes little bit. When energy state changes, the difference of energy also changes, and then the absorption energy may change. Now if it goes towards the right hand side, which is near to the red light, because red light has a wavelength of 700 nanometer, then it is called red shift. If it goes towards the left hand side, then it is called blue shift, because in this direction you have blue light. So this is the red shift, that is the blue shift. Now another two terminologies important associated with this context, and those are hyperchromic effect and hypochromic effect. Now, what is hyperchromic effect? From the terminology itself, you can know hyper means higher. When there is an increase in intensity, that is called hyperchromic effect. Suppose you have a peak now like this. So it is almost same, only the intensity increases. And this kind of thing is called hyperchromic effect. Yeah. When it goes down, the intensity goes down, this is called hypochromic effect. So now we'll be talking about chromophore. Now what is chromophore? Chromophore means the group of atoms that absorbs light, whether or not a color is thereby produced. What does it mean? You have a molecule, it has certain groups or it has some conjugations, and because of that it is capable of absorbing some sort of energy. This kind of groups or collection of groups is called your chromophore. Now in a molecule you can have more than one peak, because it is the characteristic of the molecule. The molecule may have two different chromophores, and two different chromophore may have their characteristic absorption peak. So in a molecule you can have many chromophores, and thereby you can have many peaks. So you don't be confused if you get more than one peak. You have to understand the science and you have to know the characteristic peaks. So again, I have shown some of the energy levels and the associated transitions. So this is the first one is for ethylene, second one this is in nanometer. If the energy is higher, you know the lambda is less, because energy is inversely proportional to the lambda. In this case, butadiene, the transition is this particular transition is showing 217 nanometer of wavelength. That means it is having lower energy level than the first one. And in case of hexatriene, it is the wavelength is 258 nanometer, the maximum among these three. And as the wavelength is maximum, the energy difference is the minimum. So now we'll be talking about the principle on which UV and visible spectrophotometer works. So it works basically on Lambert-Weyl law. What it tells, when light passes through a medium, then it absorbs some sort of light and the rest of the light is being transmitted. So here the absorption is defined as A is logarithm of 1 by T or logarithm of I0 by I. Now what is I0? I0 is the intensity of the incident light and I is the intensity of the transmitted light. So there will be some change of I0 to I because some light has already been absorbed by the medium. So I is obviously less than I0. So here epsilon is the molar absorptivity, C is the concentration, L is the path length, and the overall law is A is epsilon CL. And this law is valid for very low concentration of solutions. If you have higher concentration, then this law is not valid. All those things you have to know. And for that reason, in UV and visible spectrophotometer, we always suggest that you make the solution very dilute so that you get a good peak. So I have already talked about the limitations of Lambert-Weyl law, and those are high concentration, it would not work. If there is a chemical interaction or some reactions going on during the passage of light, then you may get some erroneous peaks. So all those are disadvantages. Now we'll talk about the instrumentation part of the UV. Now you have a UV light source, because I have already told you, you have a cuvette where you place the sample and one UV light is passed through the sample. So in order to pass the UV light, you should have some UV source. So what we use, so we may use deuterium lamp for UV light and tungsten filament light for the visible. Then we have monochromator. What is the work of monochromator? Monochromator makes the light one wavelength. That means you may have a radiation where more than one wavelengths are there, then you remove or you filter out the unnecessary wavelengths and you just take a particular wavelength, that is called monochromatic. Now sample holder, you to put the sample you should have some arrangement, that is called sample holder. Light detector, when the light passes through the sample and it goes out, then you should have some detector in order to see how much light has been absorbed or how much changes took place. So here I'll give you a demo. So this is the light source. Yeah, this is the light source. Now we are putting light on top of this monochromator. Now what those lines are signifying? It's signifying it has many wavelengths. Now when it passes through this monochromator, it only gives a particular wavelength, and then it goes through the sample, it absorbs some sort of light, and after it transmits, it goes to detector, and the detector detects the light, and from that it does some calculation and give you the peak. So now I'll tell you the arrangement. This is not so much important as far as your preparations for different examinations are concerned, but still I'll tell you what is happening. This is not so important, so for the time being I'm skipping it. So here is the picture of the instrument. This is the UV spectrophotometer. You have a place where you have to put the sample. You prepare the sample. This is the cubette. The distance is 1 centimeter. You put your sample, and then you put the cubette in the sample holder, and then you can run it. So what do we do by this spectroscopy? I'll tell you in brief. So suppose I need to do some quantitative analysis, or I need to do some calculation of concentration. So I have a solution. I made different stock solutions, say 0.1 to 0.02, that means 0.02 molar, 0.04, 0.06, 0.08, and 0.1 molar solution. Now we put same amount of samples every time, and we take the peak. So we can see when the concentration increases, the intensity or the absorption also increases. Now from the absorption, we make the relative absorption increment, and we do some calculations, and we prepare this calibration curve. This calibration curve means absorption intensity versus the concentration. You can see it is almost passing through a line. Now from this calibration curve, if you have some unknown sample, if you put there, you just determine the absorption, you fit it there, you will get the unknown concentration. So that is the main purpose of this calibration curve. So not only that, you can use for different purposes. Suppose you have a particular molecule which has its characteristic wavelength. Now you want to see whether this molecule is present or not. So you take the sample, you do the UV. If this characteristic peak comes, that means the sample is present there, the molecule is present there. So all these kinds of experiments you can do with UV, and there are a lot more applications which we'll be talking about in the next session of this video. So for the time being, you just prepare the topics, the things which we have covered up to the second video, and do not forget to subscribe to my channel. Please, if you like the video, please share it on social media. Thank you very much.